On behalf of Offer, I would like to welcome you tonight to our education meeting, and I would like to introduce to you Dr. Lucinda Bateman, who is going to be our guest speaker. Dr. Bateman.
That was short and sweet. That was good. I like that. So it's a pleasure to be here today. Thank you very much for coming. I know it's not easy to come to an evening meeting, especially if you are tired and have an illness going on. So today I'm going to talk to you about some new developments in the field. I'm sure those of you who are here probably are aware that there are new diagnostic criteria that have recently been published to take the place of chronic fatigue syndrome. And the new name for the illness, systemic exertion intolerance disease, is sort of new to all of us. So that's what I'd like to be talking about today. So as an introduction to talking about these new criteria, I want to emphasize some key facts. And I'm going to use the term ME-CFS because that has been the convention here in the US for a few years now to sort of link these two illnesses because of their relatedness and the need for more information. But the focus of the talk is going to be the most about what we do here in the US, because that is where this chronic fatigue syndrome case definition originated. So we have some key facts that we know from the literature, and that is 1 to 2 million Americans are affected by ME-CFS, at least, and many more worldwide. The way we record it now, and from the studies, women are more often affected than men. Unfortunately, most patients who currently get a diagnosis are Caucasian and of at least middle or upper income, which means that many, many people of other socioeconomic groups or other ethnic groups are getting even less attention and are less likely to get a diagnosis, even though epidemiology shows that it is equally present in those groups. At least a quarter of patients who get this diagnosis are bedbound or housebound at some point in their illness, and some progressively worsen throughout the course of their illness. This is a particularly neglected group because they have less ability to get into doctors, but they also are less likely to be included in research. So what we have in publications reflects the more mobile, maybe less affected people, including some of the research we all have done. Symptoms can persist for years, and most never regain their pre-illness level of health or functioning, especially adults. So the prognosis, the way we diagnose it now, the point of illness that we diagnose the illness, patients have a very poor prognosis for complete recovery from this illness. Studies show that loss of productivity and medical costs contribute to a total economic burden of $17 to $24 billion annually in this country, which is a staggering number that includes all kinds of costs, including lost productivity. And studies in the 90s suggested, these are population-based studies, that more than 80% of people, the projection is more than 80% of people never even get a diagnosis. So these are staggering numbers for an illness that we all know well, especially those of us who are here. For those of you who aren't as familiar with the background of CFS, this term was first published in 1988 in what we call the Holmes case definition, and it was well intended. They had tried to study the illness outbreak. The studies were not supporting strongly that Epstein-Barr virus caused all the cases, but it was being called chronic EBV or chronic Epstein-Barr, and now we know actually that some cases of the illness can be caused by Epstein-Barr virus. But it was an attempt to broaden the look and establish in the research a description of the illness from which we could study the illness after that. We're going to talk about the Fukuda criteria later, which replaced these Holmes criteria in 1994, because as you apply criteria, you learn more, and it seemed like it didn't fit as many people as we hoped, and the attempt was made by experts to revise the case definition. We also use other names, including ME-CFS. CFIDS, or chronic fatigue immune dysfunction syndrome, has been used, and for for many years was the name of the CFS Association of America. ME, or myalgic encephalomyelitis, is the term most broadly used outside of the US, and especially in application to the very most sick and immobilized patients with these illness symptoms. Many cases that fall under these case definitions have been called post-viral fatigue or post-infectious fatigue syndrome, and you can see these in the literature, and that's because we know that there are infections that can result in a fatigue syndrome. But it doesn't cover everyone that presents with the symptoms that fit either ME or CFS. So it's been problematic. It's not a new illness. It's worldwide, multicultural. Comparable illnesses have been documented for centuries, but historical comparisons are problematic because it wasn't that long ago that we couldn't work up hormonal diseases, autoimmune diseases, and to diagnose cancer and understand about depression. So comparisons very long ago are difficult because we don't really know what made people fatigued in the past. So I gave you a handout, just one page handout, not my entire talk, because when we start talking about these case definitions, I want you to have a little something to refer to and not have it get too confusing. But the 1994 Fukuda CFS case definition is at the top corner. I brought it up here so I could refer to it, but now it's not here. I'm sure I can remember though, the top left-hand corner of your handout. And this is what we call the CDC criteria, the Fukuda criteria. They've been called the international criteria, which isn't 100% true, but it is a good idea and well-intended for everyone to use the same criteria in research. But that has created some conflicts. The Fukuda criteria are really, they come from a published paper that's actually a very good paper that discusses all the potential causes of fatigue and how to approach a workup of fatigue. And if you have kind of exhausted all of those avenues, then it should be called chronic fatigue syndrome. So it assumes that the fatigue has been carefully evaluated, that it's otherwise unexplained, that it's persistent or lapsing at least 6 months, that it isn't lifelong, and that it results in substantial reduction in previous levels of activity. Now, lots of people who apply this case definition do not understand that, but the Fukuda criteria require that it dramatically impacts the ability to function normally and that a workup has been done. Then, in order to receive this diagnosis, you only have to have 4 of the following 8 symptoms: post-exertional malaise, cognitive symptoms, unrefreshing sleep, muscle pain, joint pain, headaches, sore throat, cervical, tender cervical or axillary lymph nodes. So I underlined post-exertional malaise in this presentation because probably that's become the most problematic aspect of case definitions, because you could meet the Fukuda criteria with only 4 out of the 8 symptoms. And you can see there are many different arrangements of those symptoms that people could fall under, but most troubling to physicians and scientists who study chronic fatigue syndrome is post-exertional malaise, because we consider that a more core criteria. And that may be why there's arisen so much confusion and contention over these diagnoses, and maybe why there's a large and heterogeneous population defined by these criteria. So you may have heard of the Canadian criteria or the Canadian consensus criteria, which is the CCC criteria. These were designed in 2003 by a committee of experts in the field. By the way, many of those experts were on the Fukuda criteria committee as well. But this was an attempt to create criteria that were more usable in the clinic. I just wanted to go back that the 1994 Fukuda criteria were really for doing research. They were to define people with kind of pure illness without anything else going on. But honestly, in the clinic, that's hard because people walk in with everything going on that's going on. So the Canadian criteria did a couple of things. One is they boosted post-exertional malaise to a required symptom. In fact, all of those first 5 symptoms under Canadian are required. So a substantial reduction in activity, post-exertional malaise, that means relapse from attempting to do things, some kind of sleep dysfunction, some type of pain, and neurocognitive manifestations are required for the Canadian criteria. And then you have to have at least 1 symptom from two of the following categories. And this is where it gets a little difficult, I think, to apply in the clinic, and some people disagree. But I've been using these clinical definitions for about 15 years, and I was only been around since 2003. But I've been using clinical criteria. So there need to be autonomic manifestations, neuroendocrine manifestations, and immune manifestations. Now, what this does is recognizes many more symptoms that occur in the illness than the Fukuda criteria. And most importantly, the autonomic, neuroendocrine, most of the others are pretty much there, depending on how you look at it. So these clinical criteria, I think, were a better description of the range of what can present with the illness. And you may know that many advocates and clinicians wanted these criteria adopted as the clinical criteria about the time that the Institute of Medicine contract was offered. But I want to emphasize that in spite of these criteria, either set of criteria, and actually there are many more, the international consensus criteria, the NICE criteria, many others, nothing has changed the fact that mainstream medicine and science continue to misdiagnose, stereotype, and not infrequently malign patients across the spectrum of, and I'm going to throw FM in here because we'll talk about this later, FM, CFS, and ME. And the sicker patients are, the more they're marginalized and left to languish because they don't fit in a box and they're hard to treat, hard to communicate with, and hard to get into clinic and have a lot of symptoms. So, to me, that's the biggest reason why something had to change. It didn't matter how much we liked those case definitions. Clinicians had no idea what they were in the whole country. No clinicians in the country knew what the Canadian criteria were. They kind of knew what Fukuda were, and they didn't like them, and they didn't like the patients, and they weren't comfortable with it. Now, there are reasons around that, and we might not be able to examine all of those. But nothing, case definitions, conferences, scientific research, publications, changed this problem. So the Institute of Medicine, which is an academic nonprofit, accepted a contract offered by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services with input and whatever kind of support however happens behind those federal doors from NIH, Centers for Disease Control, the FDA, Social Security, and ARC. This contract was offered up. The Institute of Medicine is just a body that takes on projects and tries to work with them. And this was an ordinary contract, well, not ordinary, it's what they usually do, but turned out to be an extraordinarily challenging and difficult contract, something they were not used to doing, taking on such a politically laden and difficult problem. But I commend them for doing so. And the mission of this contract was to review the existing scientific literature, analyze it, and take from the evidence that we have already published and devise a clinical case definition that doctors could use and that would teach them about this illness to change what isn't happening. It was to facilitate timely diagnosis and care and enhance understanding among health care providers and the public, but it is a clinical case definition. That means it is a definition for doctors to use in clinic to diagnose a patient. And the committee met every other month for a year, started at the beginning of 2014. You can read about it. You can go to the Institute of Medicine, iom.edu. It's the right at the top, it's on the flag, it's listed under most recent publications. Interesting projects the IOM has done, you might like going to their website. They take on projects that no one else wants to do, or there isn't funding for, or people can't come to agreement over. And they try to bring together specialists who bring expertise and put together a think tank and then go to the evidence base. So this was an amazing project, and I was able to be on this committee. The committee was made up half of people with expertise in chronic fatigue syndrome and half of people that brought needed expertise to the committee. a committee that was going to review the literature, that needed to know how to write case definitions, et cetera, et cetera. And it was a great experience to be on that committee. The final report was released in a press conference on February 10th, which was not very long ago. I would recommend that you go to the website, and there are three things on there that I think are very useful. One is the key facts. Remember my first slide? I took that straight out of the Institute of Medicine report under key facts. Second is what's called the ME/CFS Clinician's Guide. And that was not available on February 10th because it wasn't quite ready. It's a 20-page instruction describing in more detail how to make the diagnosis and some of the background that a clinician can use in the office. And of course, you can download the entire 282-page report online free. Laurel has a free copy if you would like to donate. Oh, she gave it away already because she printed out too many. This is what the bound copy looks like. You see it's pretty big. If anybody wants to come look at it, this is the clinician's report. The cover was designed specifically for this report, and it's pretty amazing. And the diagnostic criteria put forth in this report, I'm going to take some time and go over in the talk today. The committee was asked to recommend whether a new name should be used for this illness. And after listening to all the patient testimony and reading scientific papers about attitudes of physicians and taking into account the lack of progress with this illness, the stereotyping, the suffering, everything that's happened, the committee unanimously agreed that the name chronic fatigue syndrome should not be used anymore. That gave us the opportunity, given that we were a group who spent a year reviewing the literature and listening to patients and trying to put all the data together to recommend a name. And the name recommended was systemic exertion intolerance disease. So there. So let's talk about these criteria. You know, actually, before we do it, let me just say something. These four words were very carefully chosen. Systemic means an illness that affects many systems in the body at once, making it a very complex illness. Exertion intolerance comes straight from post-exertional malaise, the main feature of this illness, and that is when people try to do things, they have intolerance to it in the same way that people have gluten intolerance. Intolerance is a medical word that's used frequently. Now, maybe some people want to talk about attitudes or whatever, but that's not what this word is in this context. And the last word, disease, is a strong word, and that word was chosen to replace syndrome, to replace other words that were less concrete. A clear message to physicians, those four words, that they can't miss because they have to say it and think about it. So the core required criteria of this illness are, and there are five things, actually there's a 4A and a 4B. One is impaired function with exhaustion and fatigue. Does that sound familiar? That comes right from the other case definitions. But we didn't say fatigue, right? It describes impairment of function and, oh yeah, there's an exhaustion and fatigue. It is fatigue, but it's much more than fatigue. Number two is post-exertional malaise, or relapse on doing almost any activity, including almost any kind of a trigger or stressor, including emotional stressors, and orthostatic stressors means standing. Number three is unrefreshing sleep, or some kind of there are variable sleep issues, and then cognitive impairment and or orthostatic intolerance. And maybe we could explain a little bit more. I can just tell you as a clinician that not everyone has severe cognitive impairment who has this illness, and not everyone has dramatic or measurable orthostatic intolerance, but a lot of people have both, which is especially devastating. So we made that an even, or a part of that's the more pediatric population tends more toward the POTS and less cognitive dysfunction. These symptoms must be at least moderate to severe and frequently present. And these numbers come from a research paper that shows it distinguishes it from other illnesses if it's at least moderate to severe and at least present 50% of the time, because everybody has some of these things sometime. These are all required and they have to occur together. And then this is where some of the conflict has come in. There's a section that says other common symptoms, pain, immune impairment, and infection. They're not core criteria, but they're commonly present, and they just assist and aid in the diagnosis when they're present. So a physician should diagnose SEID after 6 months, because the criteria say to wait 6 months before a full-fledged diagnosis. And during that 6 months, they should offer supportive care and do diagnostic investigations. And the report says very clearly the patient shouldn't wait, or the physician shouldn't wait 6 months to offer care. But the care should be immediately offered for all aspects of the illness, but they should be actively engaged in trying to understand what the illness is and seeing if they can do something to remediate it during that time. There are no exclusionary criteria in this case definition. A differential diagnosis, appropriate workup of symptoms, and treatment, including referral to specialists, is expected of healthcare providers. There is no way to list in case definition everything that can look like this. And as soon as you try to do it, guess what? You miss things. That's the rest of medicine that can present with abnormal symptoms of fatigue or cognitive function or exercise intolerance or pain syndromes or reasons for not sleeping. So doctors will be expected, like every other disease, when patients present with a symptom, to assess them. And they will continue to assess them. And if the symptoms fall into place in this way, if early on it looks like this diagnosis, this can be a working diagnosis. But lots of people who present with these symptoms get better. And they probably shouldn't get a diagnosis that is a chronic illness with poor prognosis, right? Do we really want to burden people who are going to get better with that? All other identifiable illness should be diagnosed and treated, and risk factors should be corrected within the 6 months. Thus, there's no need for this exhaustive list of exclusion criteria. So again, these are the major symptoms: reduction in ability to function, accompanied by fatigue, post-exertional malaise, unrefreshing sleep, cognitive impairment, and or orthostatic intolerance. And actually in the report, it's orthostatic intolerance / autonomic dysfunction. But the data so far are stronger. We have more data for orthostatic intolerance, so we left that as the emphasis. And the other thing is orthostatic intolerance is easier to measure in the clinic. So, and then we have those other common manifestations. So we're gonna go, I'd like to go through these with a little bit more detail. And most of this, I'll tell you when I deviate from the report, comes directly from the report. And we have those diagnostic criteria, but there are several pages of references and description and literature that was used to make the decision under every symptom. I put the page numbers on there. Now, these are the page numbers of the actual pages, not the PDF. You know how it can be different. It's the number that's written on the page if you look at the PDF. So the first is this debilitating loss of function, not just fatigue. And the report goes over how the word fatigue simply does not convey the profound exhaustion and debilitation of this illness. It is severe, it negatively impacts function, but this functional deficit is a useful diagnostic tool, and we want clinicians to ask about function, because it's one of the things clinicians don't do. They don't, you know, come in, you don't know as a patient how to communicate this. They'll say, how are you doing? I'm tired. Well, you know, everybody's tired, right? You know, everybody hates that response. The communication needs to be, this is what this illness does to my ability to function. So that's what this number one is. And I want to show you, there are several measures in the literature that show that fatigue of this illness is really more severe than other chronic illnesses. You're not going to be able to read this, but this is a chart that lists other diseases and how one part of the SF-36, which is a test of function, can be compared across these illnesses. So the SF-36 is a 36 question questionnaire, and one of those scores, there are eight clusters of scores, is what we call the vitality score. And the three questions in there about different ways about asking about fatigue are added up to make the vitality score. Well, if you look at the vitality score in stage 3 congestive heart failure, it's 29 out of 100, just to give you an idea. And I think of healthy controls, it's about 60. So normal people list their vitality at around 60. It's the lowest score on the SF-36 in normal people, because we're all tired, right? We're all working too hard, we're all doing too much. So if we go across that list, HD is hemodialysis. So people on dialysis score about 49. This is self-report, they're answering questions. People with chronic hepatitis C without cirrhosis score about 48. People with major depression, about 40. This systemic sclerosis is a scleroderma, about 45 out of 100. MSD is musculoskeletal disease with at least 4 joints involved, so pretty extensive arthritis or rheumatologic disease, 48. Rheumatoid arthritis, 52. Most fibromyalgia studies, the vitality score is 38, 39. Then there are lots of CFS studies that use the SF-36, but we went to these studies and looked at the vitality scores. For CFS alone, it was 15 to 25. If you had CFS and fibro, they were around 20. If you had CFS and multiple chemical sensitivity, your vitality score was about 15. And if you had CFS, fibro, and multiple chemical sensitivities, the vitality score is about 11. That's stunning. That is an impressive impact. That's not just fatigue. So if you could learn to, if we can get instruments that can help measure function, we can learn from the literature maybe the clues. We need to have better ways of measuring how fatigue impacts function. But at least it's on there and comes to the attention of physicians. The second important diagnostic criteria, the summary of the evidence, is about post-exertional malaise. So this is an exacerbation or relapse of symptoms that occurs after physical, cognitive, emotional, orthostatic, or other stressors. There are many triggers to post-exertional malaise listed in the text, many, and that low threshold for many people. The duration varies, but it can last days, weeks, or months. And we don't have very good studies to measure post-exertional malaise. We don't even have a common way of defining it in the literature. So it's problematic. We know it's there, but it's the one thing, I think, that physicians outside the field do not understand, because it's not in the FACUDA criteria. So there's sort of an ethic of, well, get up and get going and do things, and people with this illness have to manage activity to keep the illness from being worse, which is a bit counterintuitive to physicians. So you probably know about 2-day exercise tests. So this data is included in the post-exertional malaise section, that if you do 2 cardiopulmonary exercise tests in a row on sequential days, patients with this illness cannot replicate the same parameters even with the given effort, showing that there's a physiologic process diminishing function on the second day because of the exercise on the first day. So this is listed in the report. Now, post-exertional malaise has basically been compared to healthy controls, but there are really very few studies, not just in this section, but in all the other parameters, that compare the symptoms to other chronic illnesses. And that's really needed, so we understand where it fits in. Because I think there are other illnesses where people have a consequence of exercise or being upright. We just don't, it isn't termed in that quite that way. But this is a slide from one of the studies used, and there are references there. And this shows the percentage of ME/CFS patients in blue versus control patients for each one of these symptoms. These are questions asked on a questionnaire. So on the left, minimum exercise makes me tired. 86% of people with ME/CFS said that was true, and only 7% of normal people. The second question is drained after mild activity. The third is soreness after non-strenuous activities, a dead feeling after exercise, and mentally tired after the slightest effort. There are different ways at getting at the symptom, but you see, when you have a threshold of moderate to severe and occurring at least 50% of the time or more, how this separates distinctly from other people. So that's why post-exertional malaise is a required symptom. It's supported by the evidence. The third part of the diagnostic criteria is the section on sleep. The term unrefreshing sleep actually comes from the FACUDA criteria. Other criteria use slightly different phrases, but they all talk about sleep. The NICE criteria, which we haven't talked about, use difficulty with sleeping. The Canadian criteria use sleep dysfunction. The international consensus criteria use sleep disturbance, but they all ask about sleep. And almost everyone with this illness reports some problem with sleep, even if it's only awakening, feeling unrefreshed, hence the term. And the studies show that they've looked, there are a lot of studies of sleep in this disorder, and I think there's a period of time where sleep specialists thought, oh, all these patients have sleep apnea, and we'll get them treated, they'll be fine. But the evidence supports that although those primary sleep disorders are pretty common, they are not the cause of ME/CFS. They just cause more problems when they're present. So you don't do a polysomnography to diagnose CFS. We do polysomnography to see if there's any other aspect of sleep that needs to be treated. And that was strongly supported by the literature. And these are the questions in the literature asked about sleep. I'll read, remember the blue bars are the percent of people with ME/CFS who answer that it's true, and the red bars are normal people who answer this question yes. The first one on the left is unrefreshing sleep. You can see that's the one that most people answered. Then the question was problems falling asleep, that's 68%. The need to nap, problems staying asleep, waking up early, and the shortest one is sleeping all day, awake all night. I have people like that in my practice. But it's common. Remember now, most of these patients on these trials are patients from specialist practices. So these are people who've had their illness a long time, they've learned how to manage it, they're on medications for it, and still answer the questions this way. So this is why unrefreshing sleep is a diagnostic, a part of the diagnostic criteria. How about cognition? Neurocognitive manifestations were a large part of our research. And impairments in cognitive function are frequently reported and supported by the evidence. Cognitive impairment can be measured. We don't have tests designed just for this, which we need to do. Sometimes big batteries of neurocognitive tests are super expensive and take days. And what the committee is suggesting is that we develop specific cognitive tests that will help show what's wrong in our illness. But the strongest evidence demonstrates slowed information processing. There are some data to support deficits in working memory. That's, you know, what you hold short term and use. And reduced attention, so attention, concentration, working memory. But the most well-supported cognitive problem in the literature was slowed information processing. Does that resonate? People have the illness. It's not dementia, it has its own unique. Now there are other illnesses that can do this, but those are the illnesses present. I personally believe, and this is outside of the report, that some of the frustration of doctors with patients stems from cognitive dysfunction. They don't understand it, and patients are a bit disorganized or forget things or don't seem to digest or don't follow through on instructions, and that's a frustration in a busy doctor's office. And I think calling attention to this to physicians is going to be helpful, so they can develop tools the way most of us do, you know, lists and bringing someone with you and writing things down and doing things to help with that slowed information processing and deficits in working memory and reduced attention. So there seems to be some concern that nothing recent is in this report, but the report does mention studies using functional MRI, PET scans, and EEG in the last couple of years that show altered gray and white matter, evidence of neuroinflammation. So these are small studies, they need to be replicated, they need to be done in larger groups of patients, but they lend very important evidence to these diagnostic criteria, to this aspect of the diagnostic criteria. And these were the questions that came from one of the larger multi-sites or studies that had a number of different patients from different providers. The question was problems remembering, you can see 80%, difficulty expressing thoughts, difficulty paying attention, slowness of thought, absent-mindedness, difficulty understanding. You can see the numbers aren't quite as high, but remember that some people might have more than one, or you might be able to add them up, and this is just the way they were asked, right? We have the data, people asked, this is how they answered. So in order to know bigger numbers about the presence, we would have to do new studies and ask questions in different ways. So number five is orthostatic intolerance. And to me, this is, aside from post-exertional malaise, orthostatic intolerance and autonomic dysfunction is the most important addition to these diagnostic criteria, because physicians do not ordinarily do orthostatic vital signs in a routine exam. And they don't always, those who have the disorder don't always understand why they have the symptoms. If you just fainted when you stood up, it would be easier, but that isn't usually what happens. The body compensates, there are a lot of, it's a chronic problem, and then many consequences of orthostatic intolerance. See how these sound. The main physiologic consequence to doctors of orthostatic intolerance is cerebral underperfusion. That means the brain doesn't get vigorously perfused with oxygenated blood. It causes lightheadedness, sometimes fainting, impaired cognition, disorientation, headaches, visual changes, bizarre, unusual, fleeting neurologic symptoms, and exhaustion. Would you know right away that those are symptoms of orthostatic intolerance? Well, they are, and they can be. Also, you get peripheral cardiovascular signs from orthostatic intolerance, and many of them come from the sympathetic nervous system activation. That's a squirt of adrenaline to try to compensate for this drop in blood pressure and this lack of good vascular tone. And it causes palpitations, nausea, abdominal discomfort, chest discomfort, paleness, cold hands and feet, feeling anxious, feeling short of breath, sweating, tremor. Those are symptoms that come from orthostatic intolerance. So the addition of this as diagnostic criteria covers a lot of ground and a lot of symptoms. And I would venture to say that many, many studies in the field do not always take into account the degree of orthostatic intolerance historically, because the papers on orthostatic intolerance are relatively early in the history of our understanding of this illness. And they involve tilt table testing, which is not really possible to do in everyone. But you'll find in the report that we talked about how clinicians can start to assess orthostatic intolerance. But physicians know what orthostatic intolerance is, they just need to know to look for it. And if they put it in the diagnostic criteria, they're gonna start looking for it. And I just put up here kind of the hints in the case definition. There's no mention of orthostatic intolerance or symptoms of it in the FACUDA criteria. That is one of the biggest reasons why FACUDA did not elicit the right subgroup. The Canadian criteria talk about autonomic manifestations, orthostatic intolerance, neurally mediated hypotension, POTS, lightheadedness, pallor, nausea. These are terms taken right from the criteria. The NICE criteria, as much as people don't like these criteria, mention dizziness, nausea, palpitations, recognizing these symptoms in people who present with the illness. And then the international consensus criteria, again, all of these listed symptoms could actually fall under orthostatic intolerance. So one of the reasons that the symptoms were made, that we used these diagnostic criteria, was to shrink them down to a short number that clinicians can remember and learn in recognizing the illness. So why didn't we include pain and immune impairment and infection in the core criteria? Well, pain is common, but highly variable in its presence, nature, and severity. The more severely ill people are, the more pain they have, for sure. Many forms of pain are present, including headaches, joint pain, muscle pain, and they really have different origins. So we couldn't really see something that was a fingerprint of this illness in the pain, and the pain was different than other kinds of pain. Doesn't mean it's not present. It means it's not a core required criteria. If you do that, you eliminate a lot of people who have this illness, especially people who are doing better. Their pain gets less. Immune impairment, there was sufficient evidence to say immune impairment is present, but not strong evidence to say exactly how to measure it or what kind of test could stand out, except natural killer cell function, which seems to correlate with illness severity and possibly could serve as a biomarker, at least one biomarker. What about infection? Well, we know this illness can follow infection, including Epstein-Barr virus, and there's fairly good evidence for that, but not all people with SEID or ME/CFS have EBV as the cause. And there really isn't strong evidence to conclude that EBV is still active as an infection. And there isn't any single pathogen that has strong evidence as the underlying cause of this illness. And I was part of the Chronic Fatigue Initiative pathogen discovery study at multiple sites, multiple patients, sent all the samples from every body orifice that we could come up with to Columbia, to Ian Lipkin, and they used the highest technology to try to identify a pathogen, and they were not able to do it. So you can't put infection at this point into core criteria. It looks like, smells like, we know it's there, but you can't require something when you can't put your finger on it. So this is, I just put this chart up because you can start to see how it kind of falls apart as core criteria. So there are three pain questions. Muscle pain, 73%. Headaches, 50%. Joint pain, 64%. You'd leave out a lot of people if you required widespread pain to be present in the illness. And then the immune and infection symptoms. These were just questions about sore throat and tender lymph nodes. You can see those things, and you can't tell from this, but from many other studies, including one that we're going to publish soon, sometimes those symptoms go away. They're not part of the chronic illness. So requiring them as core symptoms is not a strong diagnostic criteria, and it just adds burden to the diagnostic criteria. That doesn't mean they can't be present and part of the disease. See the difference? Now, that's the end of the slides that are specific to the IOM criteria. And what I want to do now is offer up a little bit of opinion as a clinician who has spent 15 years making a diagnosis, treating patients, and using clinical criteria to actually help people. I want to mention about fibromyalgia. This will probably get me in trouble. So chronic fatigue syndrome is researched and written about by pretty much different people that study fibromyalgia, that treat fibromyalgia, and have done the research for fibromyalgia. The chronic fatigue criteria, all those ones we talked about, focused on fatigue as the core symptom until we've added all these symptoms in to make it more specific. The fibromyalgia criteria in 1990 only require chronic, widespread pain and tenderness. Very simple. No exclusionary criteria, nothing. If you have pain all over, that's pain amplification. And we are starting to understand the physiology of this. It's neurologic in it. Recently, we've had some studies to suggest there might be a small fiber polyneuropathy driving it in some people. We know that pain transmission is ramped, that drugs that work in the central nervous system to calm that help, and that's where the drugs for fibromyalgia were developed. Well, people with chronic fatigue syndrome can have fibromyalgia symptoms, which is pain amplification. They're not separate illnesses. Not everyone has it. We also know that when you have primary fibromyalgia, you develop these symptoms, particularly the mild ones, that you have fatigue and cognitive and sleep disturbances. Does that sound familiar? And these are just the tender point criteria. Well, the American College of Rheumatology published a change in the fibromyalgia criteria in 2010, and they said, well, let's do away with tender points. That's hard. Doctors never learn it. They haven't been doing it. You're really not giving this illness the credibility it deserves. So they devised a scale that scored the pain, called the widespread pain index, and these are these different areas, and you just check off where the pain is. This is the words, I just threw the diagram in to be artistic there. And if you have, there are 19 areas listed there, and we score it, that's the WPI, then you get a score on fatigue, sleep, cognitive complaints, and then widespread complaints, like all these other multiple symptoms. And if your WPI is more than 7 and your symptom score is more than 5, they can call that fibromyalgia. Well, a study was recently done and published. This was just published in February, this last month. And they went out, they did a survey of 1,600 people, if they had fibromyalgia symptoms, they brought them in, they brought them into clinic, they did tender points, they did a workup, they applied the case definition, and only 1.7% met the 1990 criteria, and 5.4% met the new criteria. So That's almost that's three times more people met the criteria. And I think it's, we have to, when we make new criteria, you've got to apply them and compare them and see how it groups people. But I use this example to understand, to help you understand that when we say criteria, we're talking about criteria we use to select or group people. We're not really talking about the illness itself, per se. And the illness can span many forms and many severities and have overlaps with other illnesses. Now I want to really muddy the water and say, so here's a Fukuda criteria. If you have fibromyalgia, and we'll say it's primary fibromyalgia, meaning it's not caused by some other illness, you just have fibromyalgia. If you look down at the bottom, you have widespread pain and tenderness, you have problems with fatigue and sleep and cognition, and those red things in the Fukuda criteria are those symptoms. So if you have enough fatigue that alters your function, and you have cognitive, sleep, and then you've got muscle, joint, and headaches, that would qualify for fibro criteria if those were the boxes you checked for the Fukuda criteria. So this creates a lot of confusion and overlap, and one of the reasons I bring this up is I don't know what a patient really has when they tell me they have fibro, they have CFS, because it's not uniformly applied out in medicine. And I don't like people taking sides and saying, no, you know, only people with this diagnosis are important or only people with that criteria are important. It's all important. And the most sick people have meet criteria for both illnesses. The least sick people with fibro, even though it's a miserable condition, improve when we treat their sleep, use pain modulators, work on stress management, and gentle exercise. And sometimes, and lots of medicines are helpful for fibro. And I love getting a fibro patient because I can really make them a lot better. And one of the most important interventions these days is low-dose naltrexone. And this works in a number of ways we're trying to understand, but we think it stabilizes glial cells in the central nervous system so they're not as inflammatory and causing problems with pain pathways. And I've had the great, really wonderful experience of helping people's fibromyalgia in the last year with low-dose naltrexone. So this is very promising, but what it shows is if you treat the pain amplification, the pain comes down and the fatigue improves, and that is really exciting. But most people who meet SCID don't have that kind of dramatic response to low-dose naltrexone, not to say it isn't helpful in some cases. All right, I'm going to make you all doctors. These are real. If you happen to recognize yourself in these diagrams, I want you to know they are de-identified. There are no names up here. Don't try to figure out who they are. Just look at it, okay? So here is a patient. And you can see the symptom scores for fatigue, mood, body aches, pain, headaches. You know, on the right is the 10, that's bad. And no symptoms is on the left. And the symptoms tend to cluster. So this person has everything. Headaches are the least problematic. And although it isn't a dramatic picture, every place that can hurt is filled in on that pain diagram. So what does this person have? Fibro? CFS? SCID? ME? Can you tell me what this person has? No, you can't actually. I will tell you that I can't tell what a person has from their symptoms and their pain diagram. Not from these symptoms. You have to ask about function, about post-exertional malaise. You have to ask questions and work up the sleep. You've got to understand cognitive complaints. I mean, you have to apply the criteria and you have to assess for orthostatic intolerance. That was a funny choice of words. Anyway, and those are things a physician can do in the clinic and make a diagnosis. What does this person have? Do you know what this person has? This person feels horrible. That's clear, right? This person feels horrible. 10 pluses and really bad pain diagram. So do you know what this person has? You don't, actually. You don't know what this person has. But this person needs help and can get treatment. And honestly, the illness, I know exactly whose people are in this person, and this person are equally disabling. And neither one is responding very well to treatment, honestly. And I threw this up because, let's see what time it is. I used this in a talk a long time ago to some people who were researchers. And they said, what are the subsets of chronic fatigue in your clinic? So I just made out this list. And these are the kind of subgroups I see in the clinic. One is post-viral fatigue in young people with really dramatic autonomic and orthostatic symptoms, POTS. And they can wax and wane, and a lot of them get better, actually. Sometimes not very quickly, and sometimes they don't get all better. They probably have one of the better prognoses. Number two is what I think of, most of us think about ME, which is a sudden flu-like onset, middle age, devastating, heavy cognitive dysfunction, sometimes a lot of pain, very little exercise tolerance. I'll tell you that that first group, you can get doing some exercise sometimes, depends on the person. Also, you can morph from group to group, I have to say. The next is gradual onset following weeks to months of stressful circumstances, usually mental and physical stressors, often pain predominant, usually hormone shifts, poor sleep, and sometimes depression and anxiety, and low impact exercise helps. That's fibromyalgia. That's what I would consider to be fibromyalgia, mild to moderate fibromyalgia. And it's really common, and it's actually more treatable. The next one is definite but not sudden onset, associated with a complex web of mental and physical stressors. Like people get treatment for cancer, and they have surgery, and exposure, and radiation, and you know, fears, and trauma, and everything all rolled into one, and when they come out the other end, they're not the same. And I've had people do that, come out as sick as number two. Cognitively impaired, no longer able to function, and then there are milder versions of it. There are also some really important fatigue presentations associated with anxiety disorders, and it's not just the anxiety. Somehow that state of being in that very stressed state for a long time results in symptoms. And although the CFS criteria excluded bipolar disorder, people who are bipolar can get horrible fibromyalgia because they have stress and disordered sleep. And it's real fibromyalgia. It's not just bipolar, and you can't just treat it by improving their mood. And then the last one is just people who have way too many things going on, all adding in together to create illness. Being overweight, having sleep disorders and allergies, and many, every different joint hurts and headaches and everything all together. So all these people can meet criteria, and they all need help, and they're all probably going to be treated in different ways. So we have a lot of challenges on our hands. I do think that the SEID criteria are going to help sort out some of those things. Now, I also want to throw out that this is what makes diagnosis challenging. Confounding conditions. The first is a list of things that make it impossible to know what's going on with people, actually. So psychotic illness, really severe mental health problems, very severe obesity, because people just feel horrible and they're carrying that much weight around, and then people who are abusing substances, because they're just really hurting their body. It's really hard to tell what's going on with them. But there are a lot of medical conditions, and I just listed the ones that are more subtle, not the obvious ones that doctors are going to pick up. But these can all happen to our patients. Medication side effects, nutritional deficiencies, underlying infections, primary sleep disorders. I don't know why those are indented there. They shouldn't be. But allergies, we picked up people with heart defects that when they were fixed and they got better. Sometimes autoimmune diseases, neurologic diseases, hormone problems, and getting side effects like statin, you know, from the cholesterol-lowering drugs, having it cause neuromuscular problems. So these are the kind of things we try to dig up when people come to the clinic to see if it's causing their symptoms. But usually it's just aggravating their symptoms because these are ordinary things that happen to people. And same with, you know, it's hard to live with these illnesses. You get depressed, your life falls apart. People get overtraining syndrome, and most of them, not people with this disorder, but people who are really athletic and sometimes push their body way too far until it starts to break down. Most people with chronic illness get deconditioned, and that adds new symptoms of fatigue, orthostatic intolerance and depression, and just being burnt out, you know, all those things can make it look like this illness, and they can happen on top of this illness. And then there are these other illnesses that we define by symptoms that can happen in an overlapping way in the same population. A couple more slides. Can you tell what this person has? I can tell you that this person got almost all better on one drug and some suggestions about behavioral changes. Okay? So that was good. She didn't really have CFS. And there are three slides. This is a 19-year-old woman that came to me. You can see she's got a lot of symptoms and some pain. Her most important symptom was her fatigue, and then was were pain issues, and then brain fog. This was her a year later, and this was her 2 years later. And I want to go back through that. I want you to just look at the pain diagram. So here's on presentation, here's a year later, and here's 2 years later. That's in spite of everything we did to try to help her. She just became sicker and sicker, and she is bedridden and cannot walk. I love this one. Now, do you get some communication from that pain diagram? Knife-like pain in the chest, headaches, feet burning. Really. Do you know what this patient has? This person has diabetes and peripheral neuropathy and fibro and sleep apnea. So the message I have is we are all in this together. These new criteria are intended to help doctors recognize the primary symptoms of this illness and be better at diagnosing them. I think they're going to be helpful if we can move them along. We're going to have a lot of opinions about whether this is a good name or not. We all need to join together and leverage and utilize the resources we have and dive in and move this illness into mainstream medicine and science. And there's something everyone can do. Patients can take better care of themselves, volunteer for research, talk to politicians, raise money and donate to your favorite projects. Providers all need to learn how to diagnose this illness and care for patients and share clinical observations. It shouldn't be one or two or three CFS clinicians in the country. Every clinician should recognize this illness and contribute to what we know about it, and same with scientists. And I think the federal agencies are really on target to try to help with this, and hopefully these new criteria will convince academic institutions that this is a really important illness. All right, that's the end of my talk. I have a few other slides to reference, but I think what we want to do is maybe take some questions. Is anybody brave enough to ask questions?
I know it's all the bar graphs. We had the charts of the bar graphs as a community definition.
Actually, that study, patients had to, I'm pretty sure, had to meet criteria for both Fakuda and Canadian, but I could be wrong. Okay. Okay. Well, actually, the majority of research uses Fakuda.
Yeah, so what are the chances that are going to pull in people that don't actually have any symptoms?
And have those symptoms like that? Well, that study was done by people who were diagnosed in CFS specialty clinics or already had a diagnosis of CFS, so nobody can answer that. You know, this was to look at the existing publications and take from what we have and try to form it into something that has some strength supported in the literature. So, and if you read the report, you will see all over in it the deficiencies in the literature and recognition that we have to draw from heterogeneous studies. But I would say that most studies that are done in CFS clinics, those clinicians use Fakuda, but they actually diagnose a subset of Fakuda because most of them require post-exertional malaise. So it's really out in the clinic where Fakuda becomes problematic, where people don't understand the presentation of illness. I feel pretty confident that those symptoms represent the majority of people that the way we diagnose the illness now.
My other question is, since SEID is a clinical case definition, what would be the research case definition going forward?
I don't know. So her question is, if this is a clinical case definition, what will be the research case definition going forward? There's pretty clear consensus that there are two huge deficits in the field. One is knowledgeable clinicians who can accurately diagnose and offer care to patients. So this is an attempt to try to move the ball forward on that one. In terms of research case definitions, my own opinion is it doesn't matter what you use as long as you say what you use. And it would be nice if everybody used the same ones, but as long as you know how people define it, you interpret the case definitions that way. But I think we should have the most specific and narrow case definitions we can when we do studies. And hopefully this kind of a report will allow people to say, this is a group of people who met these criteria and had this. And we applied this, and here's what we learned from it. So you don't have to have a perfect case definition. You just have to be clear about who you include. And the condition of the prior case definitions made it so that was very difficult. It was very hard to know sometimes how people were chosen and how they met criteria when they were included in the studies.
A couple questions. I'm just curious why the clinician's guide was labeled NCFS.
Yeah, that's a good question. So her question is, why is the clinician's guide labeled ME/CFS in the report instead of SEID? And the answer is that the committee recommended a name change, but they're not the boss of name change. So until, and the committee was contracted by DHHS to complete the report, and the report was done and delivered to DHHS. So it would be a little presumptuous to change all the materials to use the new name until there's some vetting of the name. But it doesn't create some problem because all the materials are made using the old name. So just the way it is, it was discussed, and the clinician's guide does put SCID in parentheses. So there's some reference. I think the old name can never go away, right? Because there's a literature using the old name. We need to understand the old name and what it was. And there were questions to me about diagnostic codes, and maybe I'll address that right now. The report suggests that a new diagnostic code, an ICD-9 CM code, which is the ones we use here, not the WHO international codes, be assigned to SCID. That we stop using, there are codes for CFS and fibromyalgia, and we stop using the code, the CFS. This doesn't exactly replace CFS, right? It's not the same diagnostic criteria. So we're saying use new diagnostic criteria, and when you apply those diagnostic criteria, call it this. You can't just slip a name in to the old criteria, they're not the same. It doesn't select the same group of people. So it takes time for these recommendations to be implemented. Doctors code every day. We all know how to improvise with codes. We can use the old codes till a new code comes. And I didn't mention, but if you noticed in the slide, there's no code for POTS, neurally mediated hypotension. There's a POT for, there's a code for orthostatic hypotension, but that's not exactly what people have. There is a code for dysautonomia, and I finally discovered it, and now I'm using it for everything. So I'm probably in trouble for that. But the code issue is sort of slow moving, and the recommendation is that happen. How long it will take to be implemented, I don't know. I think there was one hand down here I was going to come back to. We can put the slides on the website. Yeah. Where else? Yeah. Angela's question was, who determines these codes and what's the process? And the answer is, I honestly do not really know enough to give you a good answer.
How about the name?
Who determines the name?
It's the boss.
You know, it's kind of like herding cats. So the question is, who decides the name? And I'm not really sure. So the IOM? If we felt like we were in a good position we're in as good a position as any to recommend a name. We've been immersed in this. We've gotten a lot of patient input. Honestly, I've been part of this field for a long time, and no one has been able to come up with a name. And there's been a lot of suggestions and no ability to move forward on a new name. And the biggest problem with ME as a name couple of problems. One is that the evidence base is not quite up to the standard of an evidence review to call it that in terms of inflammation, neuroinflammation. We're really, really close, but the timing is just not quite right. So you're supposed to have, you know, large studies, replicated studies. There are some standards about what kind of evidence is kind of irrefutable evidence. My argument is, when we create new diagnostic criteria, we can't say this is now ME. ME has its own case definition, and people have a diagnosis of ME. You can't just take over the name of something else that's defined by other criteria. So it is difficult. So the solution was, we're going to put forward these clinical criteria, and when people meet these clinical criteria, we suggest it gets called this. And there is some reason to call that in terms of identifying the symptoms. And in the report, it says this might be a transient or a working name until subgroups are better identified. And I think there are at least two major subgroups that fall under SCID in terms of the patients with more peripheral POTS and autonomic disease. This is my opinion. And people that become really ill with what seems more like a neuroinflammatory process, and then probably some other overlap. But that's why we need to take this as a foundation and do more research. But believe me, this provides a much better foundation than what we had before. If a scientist is interested in neurocognitive symptoms, they can go to that section, they can read the entire bibliography, and they can decide where they want to go from there. Same with post-exertional malaise. People want to say, what's post-exertional malaise? How should we define it? They can go and they can read a concise bibliography and an explanation about what the literature has shown to date. So this provides a very good foundation for people who want to take the next step. Yeah?
I'm just curious, is there some sort of plan that the IOM endorses to disseminate this information to the medical community or to the public? At this point in time, if an individual with this disease tells a clinician or a friend, I have SCID, they're going to look at you like you're a made-up disease. I've never heard of it.
Right. So the question is, did the IOM recommend a dissemination plan? There's actually a great section that was part of the statement of task to recommend dissemination plan. There's a wonderful section on ways to disseminate. And it's actually not the role of the IOM to implement the dissemination plan, per se. So all of that's been handed back to the people at DHHS who commissioned the report. So things like this is true of everything the IOM does. They make a recommendation, and then the cats are out there. You can't tell people what to do. People are in academics. They've been doing things a long time. There was just a post today in Medscape that gave some opinions about how to treat this illness that I don't think reflected the criteria. But you know what? That's a doctor. That's that doctor's opinion. And everybody can voice their opinion. So if we want to put more things out there, we need to put more things out there. But the dissemination will happen slowly, hopefully, because the IOM is an influential and respected body, and then we'll see what the federal agencies do to facilitate it. Oh, I thought you had a question. Yeah, you still have a question. My glasses must be, I have new glasses, they must be making my eyes work.
Yes, it appears to me that the fibromyalgia.
Yes, so the comment is that fibromyalgia appears to be a central nervous system problem more and more, and maybe SCID does too, and I agree. I think, but there are some aspects of the illness that might not be central, but maybe peripheral. But I do think it lends itself to neurologic problems more than anything. And I think that may be why it's been in the wrong camp. It's like the ugly duckling, right? That it really hasn't been appreciated and recognized because we aren't looking at it with the right eyes and the right tools. But even in neurology, in the past hasn't really had the tools to diagnose this kind of illness, but we're moving that direction, really a lot more understanding about neuroinflammatory illness and autoimmune conditions that impact both the peripheral and central nervous system. Right, so the interplay of your central nervous system and not just the peripheral nervous system, but your entire system and then is very complex and a feedback mechanism that once it gets going, it's hard to tell where the problem started. It's hard to tell if it's central or peripheral because there's constant feedback and adaptation and change. So I think it's gonna be interesting. And hopefully if we get on, I really believe this is all solvable. We just haven't had people eyes on. We can't have just a few people thinking about this. We need to have everybody thinking about this in medicine and science across fields. Get it into the competitive place where people are interested and want to make progress, and I think it's going to move quickly. I think we know a lot. We just haven't put the pieces together. The right people haven't been interested. So we can work on that. Any other questions? Okay, let's have a new question, then we'll come back to you.
What kind of specialists would best support SEIG in the
So the question is, what kind of specialists would best support SCID and the new clinical criteria? Well, it's the same problem, you know, as it has been, and that is that it's a bit much for primary care. We want primary care to be able to recognize primary care can make these assessments. They can do orthostatic, you know, they can ask questions. They can understand when symptoms are present. They may need specialists to assure them that it's not another problem. Down the road, hopefully it'll land or nestle somewhere, you know, in a specialty area once we have the science a little more clear. So far, nobody really wants to claim it because it's intimidating, right? It's an illness that we don't understand very well, but I think we can make more progress. So the question is about the study that was recently published that showed different cytokine profile at different stages of illness. This is a study that has been going on a long time, actually. The paper just came out. This is part of that chronic fatigue initiative study where we did the pathogen discovery study looking for what might be causing, what infection might be causing the illness. But lots of other blood was drawn. And immune markers and cytokines and many other kinds of tests. So as money and time permitted and they were able to look deeper and deeper into this, they started looking at these panels and they were trying to be creative about how to look at this mountain of data. And one of the ways to look at it was, especially with the thought, is this an infection that morphs into an autoimmune disease? If that's true and you look at other kinds of infections that evolve into autoimmune disease, there's sort of a time period. And so they looked at that less than 3 years, more than 3 years, and we will see a statistical difference in the way the cytokines presented. So that's useful information. It validates the illness as being, and there were controls. This is a large study. There were normal controls. And then we had the time of the length of illness, and we're able to, you know, pull those factors out to show both differences in patients and controls and differences at the stage of illness. So every little piece of data that we can establish in the literature is important because people build on that. And this came from a great respected institution. It was a large study, it had controls, and it was a really high quality study. So that's what makes it so important, not just what they found, but that it was a real finding and it was one that is not going to be easily dismissed.
I understand that it's sort of medicine.
What is Institute of Medicine? Yes.
Was there any involvement or input from the community?
No, the Institute of Medicine just convened this body of people, and the Institute of Medicine is part of the National Academies of Science. So it is a nonprofit, but it's they do lots of different projects, and there's a staff that becomes part of the committee to help paperwork and some of the writing and, you know, organizing and facilitating a smooth process. But the members of the committee are all volunteers who volunteer their time, hundreds of hours of everybody on that committee volunteered their time. But it's just what it is. You know, it's just a project. It's like a think tank, and had a very specific goal in mind and finished and wrote it. And that's all it is at this point. And that's.
I'm just wondering because my own concept line is very popular.
Yeah, they're pretty. Yeah, people are not happy about this new name. And but my. The way I look at this is we have not made any progress really for two decades to speak of in this field. So something had to change. It just wasn't working. So I'm all for change and trying things.
One of the slides said that PEM has not been studied compared to other illnesses, but if I recall correctly, the mice compared prevention studies.
Yeah, but we're talking about one study, unreplicated, small numbers. There were like 15 fibromyalgia patients. So we're not talking, this is from the report, so they're making statements that are evidence-based statements. So when you say there's not enough evidence, it means the evidence doesn't reach this level of credibility. It's hard to understand the lingo. You really need to understand the lingo so it doesn't sound offensive. So, but that's technically what it means. All right, well, I think maybe we can close unless there are any pressing questions. I think the Institute of Medicine fulfilled their contract. I think the product has some power and can really make a difference. How it will all sort out in terms of the name and what moves forward, I don't really know. It's not the job of the committee to determine that. There's always the opportunity for input to federal agencies, I hope it jostles things up and we make progress. So thanks for coming, and thanks for your response.